Thank you for watching Conscious Consumer Network. The live stream broadcast is free to view. You can pause and rewind live broadcasts to catch up, or view shows at a later date by accessing our free archives of all shows. Check out our broadcast guide to see what's on. You can show your support by donating to our network support fund. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter, or subscribe to the monthly newsletter for updates. We thank you for supporting free and independent media. The mainstream media and international community have largely ignored the atrocities and genocide that is going on in my home country of South Africa. As economic refugees living abroad, we as independent media fight to expose the truth and find solutions for the many suffering and impoverished people still stuck in South Africa. This is Stop South African Genocide, hosted by Mel V and Karin Smith, live on CCN.
Dit staan al eeuwe teen die muur, hang een krans om jou nek, want die tafel is gedek. Vir een feest, vir een maal, vir die geluk wat jou kan kom haal. Bring een lied, bring een woord, bring een kreet en bring een koor. My hart loop halleluja, iemand sê amen. My hart loop halleluja, iemand sê amen. Daar is goud in die son, daar lê hoop in wat mag kom. Skink 'n glas op jou droom, stort jou liefde in 'n stroom. Laat dit loop, sonne vrees, laat dit iets vir iemand wees. Bring 'n lied, bring 'n woord, bring 'n kreet en bring 'n koor. My hand op halleluja, iemand sê amen. My hand op halleluja, iemand sê amen. My hand op halleluja, iemand sê amen. Amen. My hand op halleluja, iemand sê amen. Oh 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 oh.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Mel V, coming to you live on Conscious Consumer Network this fine evening. And it is so great to be with you all because it is our end of year show here on Stop South African Genocide. This 19th of December, it's 7 p.m. GMT. And of course, we are joined first off by my most esteemed co-host, Karin Smith. A big hello, Karin, but also to two of the most amazing people in the Boer struggle. First off, I want to say a big hello to Steve Hofmeyr. Hello, Steve.
Guys, how are you? Mel, Karin, and Ed, it's an honor. Thank you very much.
And of course, Ed Begley, my dear friend, and we worked together previously. He was in my film, The Last of the Boers. It's so great to have you with us, Ed.
Well, thank you for having me. It's a real honor for me.
Well, tonight is a very special evening because we've been able to bring you two together. It's been a real challenge to kind of coordinate getting both of you because obviously, Steve, we know you're a very busy musician
And Ed's also extremely busy, like the rest of us, trying to survive and trying to get the workhorse out there. So I think I'm actually going to go to Steve and say, let's talk a little bit about your background and how you came to be on this particular journey at this time, talking about these things that have been going on in South Africa.
Well, I started, I can go real far back. I suppose that the Hofmeyr family comes from, I would say, somewhere on the border between Germany and Holland, before there was a border. And then one of the Hofmeyrs went to Rotterdam, and after that one of them came to the Cape. It's a quite a well-documented journey of the Hofmeyrs. So we've been in South Africa for about 300-400 years. Very often I get asked, you know, why don't you leave Africa? Why don't you go somewhere else if you don't like it here? But I can trace my family tree back to 1790, and most of the people who I ask if they could do the same can't, because literacy only came to this country 100 years ago for the First Nations anyway. So no, I'm an African Afrikaner. We call ourselves Afrikaner. We stole the word. It's stuck with us forever. The older version of us is called the Boers. If you date back 100 years during the Anglo-Boer War, we don't mind. You can call us any of those. There are differences between them. I understand that, but I don't mind. I react to both Afrikaner or Boer. We are predominantly white. We are Western. We have brought over some of the Western habits to Africa. This has stood us in good stead, because there was nothing in Africa, of course. So many of the things worked here. Many of the things didn't work here. Some of the technology didn't work here. Some of the farming habits of Europe didn't work in Africa. Africa is a tough place to become a farmer. But we all have the DNA of farmers in us, the food trekkers, or the Freeburgers, the Freiburgers, as we call them. They also moved away. It seems that my group always, since putting foot on this continent, was a minority and never happy with who was ruling them. They were very seldom ruled by themselves. They have fought for sovereignty all their lives. They've had glimpses of it, the Afrikaner, when they got it right once, after many wars, many graves, and many contracts, the world decided to call that sovereignty apartheid and took it away from them with sanctions, etc. And so in today you can't bully a minority like that, but it seems like in the 50s and 60s you could. We can get back to the details of this discussion and why I call it like that. It was called apartheid. It was taken away. I also see the new South Africa then as a partnership between the whites and the blacks. I'm going to generalize now just to make the conversation flow. It was a partnership. We got together and decided we will share the country. I was very young when that happened. It was 30 years ago when that decision was made. Today, I think that decision was a dagger in the back of my people. But in those days, I thought, let's prevent war. Let's share this damn old country. It's big enough for everybody. And us, little 5 million people, went into a partnership with the other 50 million people. And the moment we signed away the sovereignty, it was taken away forever. Everything was taken away. Everything that qualifies for genocide was taken away, which means your habits, your cultural habits, your standards, your language, your university, your places of schooling, everything was taken away. We have this year, 2017, I remember 2017 is the year that we sacrificed the last of our Afrikaans universities. That means 21 world standard universities evaporated. I must add that last university is Stellenbosch, and it's in an Afrikaans province, which means a predominantly Afrikaans-speaking province. It shows you the kind of loss that we're sitting here with, and why we get a little agitated. Listen, that's the politics of it. I just grew up as a boy in the Free State. That's the center of South Africa. It's quite a dry area. It's a rural kind of area. And my dad played songs by Chris Christopherson and Neil Diamond on his guitar. And when I could get my arms around the guitar, he taught me those songs. And very soon I saw that you got a very different kind of attention from adults if you could play the guitar and if you could play the songs they liked, of course. So I would work out Roger Whittaker. I'd work out Elvis Presley. And you'd do a couple of the Bee Gees songs. All the music gets very familiar to you as well. Then after school, I went to the army, which was a compulsory 2 years army stint in South Africa. After that, I went to drama school. I wanted to become a radio DJ, basically what Mel and Karin is doing right now. And I went to drama school for that, and I just fell in love with the discipline of theater. And I started making movies and lots of theater, started writing a lot as well. But all those nights after classes, I would join the band and we'd go play somewhere. We were a terrifyingly disgusting band. We were pretty useless as well, but we got the crowd entertained. In the beginning, we had 20 songs, and we sang the 20 songs over and over, but we kept the people entertained for 4 hours, and I suppose that's what I became at the end of the day. I'm probably not the greatest musician out there, but now it's 30 years later. I've recorded 30 CDs. I've written about 220 songs, about 11 books, and I've done about 8 or 9 or 10 movies. So I must be the happiest entertainer in the world. Everything turned out quite good for me. I went through the old, I started in the old South Africa during much of the turmoil, and I think my career did well in the new South Africa. I'm not sure if I should say thanks to anybody or in spite of everybody, but it seems that the last thing you can take away from the people who are marginalized all over the world is the basics of their culture, and that's their songs. And their words, their spoken language, then, if you're going to take away their written language. And that's the story. We're back in 2017, 30 years after my first number one hit. I had a number one hit now with the current CD. And I'm proud the people are there. They catch me. It's my market. I do have black and brown and colored and Indian and white and German fans, which I'm very proud of, but predominantly I'm an Afrikaans singer and I'm an Afrikaner artist, and those are the people who come to my concerts. Tickets are expensive. They are there every night, 4 times a week, and they've been there 4 times a week for 30 years. That's my story summed up.
Wow. It's amazing.
Yeah, I'm still amazed as well.
You know, because we all know how tough the music industry can be, and it's just amazing that you've been able to make it good. But you've obviously got a lot of talent. So, you know, obviously there's a space for people like you. And also when you've got a space and you've got a voice, you kind of do feel an obligation to speak up when you see things that are innately wrong and corrupt in society.
I think the one came before the other. The chicken kind of came before the egg, which means you sing, you are successful, you have this platform, you reach more people than the politicians eventually. You reach more people on different social media platforms, television, radio, books, media in general. And you start realizing, only as I became an older singer, I started realizing that there is a bit of a responsibility here towards your people. They climb in their cars with their families, they drive 200 kilometers over graveled road to come see the concerts that you do. And when they take away those people's language, you seem to have a little power to say something, but you're not. It was inevitable that I would become a cultural animal and an activist. I'm a latecomer to it. It's only about 12 years ago that I started realizing there's an abnormal mortality rate under our farmers, and farmers is predominantly my market as well. Because apart from the cities, the 4 or 5 cities we have in South Africa, I travel the rural areas, which are our farmers and our small towns. And I come from a small town, so I understand the people very well. So yes, to sum up, it was inevitable that I had to become an activist. I don't understand why other artists don't do it, because if this culture disappears, that very successful nucleus of entertainment disappears as well. Do you think I'm going to sell music to the Zulus or the Khoisas? many of the whites and the Afrikaans guys have tried, but it doesn't work like that in entertainment. You can force people to do any body you want them to be in politics, but when it comes to choosing your culture and your entertainment, I cannot prescribe to you. There's nothing I can do to make you like a different kind of music or a different kind of entertainment.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Ed, I'm going to come to you now, but I just want to actually, you touched on a very good point there, Steve, which I think for me, it is really one of the key fundamental principles that people seem to misunderstand, particularly people from outside South Africa. They think of if you were anti-apartheid, you were pro-freedom. Which, you know, as looking back now, we kind of realize, hang on, that's not really what happened. And you look at people like President Verwoerd, who propagated a concept of Bantustans, which gave the natives their own self-governing homelands, and really was, as you said, the first time we actually had sovereignty and it was taken away from us. I want to hear you talk a little bit more about this and how you view this.
Although I'm seen sometimes, I've been called an apartheid apologist. That's a bit of a strange thing, because the moment somebody asks me if apartheid was better, I'm the first one to say, well, not everything was not everything was better. And as soon as people suffer, I can't agree with the system. But it seems that before you can discuss apartheid, that the very same thing happens to you that when you discuss racism, you have to get a consensual definition. And it doesn't seem that there is one for racism. There certainly isn't one for apartheid. Apartheid could be one of 10 things. It could be a period. It could be a system. It is also an economic system. It could be a political system. It could be a very ugly crime against humanity, if you want it. When it comes to discussing apartheid, we're going to have to clear up which one of those we discuss. Let's go with the general one that is supposed to be a crime against humanity. Apartheid was voted a crime against humanity. Of course, the only nations who voted that for that were, of course, the partners of the Russian states in Africa as well. Many countries in Europe, America itself, and I believe Britain did not agree that apartheid was a crime against humanity. But the most important part about a crime against humanity, or apartheid if you want, is that what follows that, when you supersede it and when you improve on that system, you must make sure that you do not have any of those crimes against humanity in your new system, in your improved morality. You got to make sure that you have fewer deaths in detention than during apartheid. And apartheid was seen as a crime against humanity because of its deaths in detention. We have quadrupled the deaths in detention in South Africa. So we failed the definition of crime against humanity. If you asked me this 30 years ago, I would have given you a different answer. But apartheid for me, there's only two ways to discuss it. The one is that it didn't exist, which I think is a tough one, because I know some people who have the scars to prove it. The other one is that you agree that pretty much everything is about separateness. Pretty much everything is about apartheid. You can call it anything you want, and apartheid will be the pejorative. But the whole world is practicing apartheid right now. When you are erecting a fence, when you are checking and rechecking your immigration policies out there, you are practicing separateness. And that is what apartheid means. They gave it an Afrikaans word to make us look bad, but it's just a synonym for separateness. And the history of separateness goes very, very far. So when that minority got their sovereignty, it didn't come easy. There were two wars against the British. The first one we won. That little minority actually won a war. Many years, a decade or so later, we started the Anglo-Boer War. And that one we lost eventually. Started a union with the crown, and this union carried on until about 1948, when the Afrikaner government became independent. I need to ask you, as international commentators, do you really think that in 1948, when for the first time we became a republic, we got our independence after 300 years, the world expected us to take that independence and pass it on to someone else because they were a numerically a majority or more? It had nothing to do with history. Democracies were coming about there. Majoritarianism was the big buzzword back in the 50s and 60s. So you could, by virtue of being more than anybody else, by virtue of having more children than anybody else, swipe off the table any claims they have on that sovereignty, be it wars, be it graves, be it the 30,000 graves of the women and children during that war I'm speaking about, the contracts between my ancestors and, of course, the black ancestors. All those things were swept from the table because one group was seen as the numerical more. The Verwoerd, as you mentioned, resisted that. He also knew that it could carry on as it was going. He misjudged the population explosion from the black side as well. You must understand, this is not quite like Israel, where the line that is drawn does to a degree separate the people. Everybody was already inside the same border, inside the same country. And the only way to get out of that, there were only two ways. The one everybody was screaming for, America was screaming for that, the Scandinavians were screaming for that, Europe was screaming for that, is you have to integrate. But for a small minority, that would be death. That would be instant death. You integrate, you disappear. So I could not see my ancestors or Hendrik Verwoerd at any stage given to that one. The other one was, give these First Nations back their original homelands where they came from, which is difficult to determine in hectares and square meters for the simple reason that they did many things. They moved around, they were nomads, they were completely wiped out during the 19th century in a inter-tribal war called the Mfikane. The Zulus were easier to establish because they had KwaZulu-Natal, the province in the east. So, of course, today black folk are claiming back the land in square meterage. Strangely, ironically, they didn't own it in square meterage ever. So that's a lie already. Please let us get back to compensation and reparations, because I don't agree with reparations or compensation over generations. I see you have the same problem in America. Do not stand for it. Do not fall for it. You are creating new victims. They will be back in the future to claim back theirs, and so it'll carry on ad infinitum. You are also, of course, punishing the wrong generation. Yeah, so I'm speaking long-windedly, but I hope I get around to what Favut meant. I think his intentions were good. I still think he's one of the greatest presidents we ever had. I think he had a tough one to solve, and I'm glad I wasn't in his shoes.
Oh yes, absolutely, yes. That's totally our point of view. And you know, you say this to the average person who's been indoctrinated that Mandela's a hero and apartheid is evil, and they think that you're a bad person for saying that Favut was a good man. But we live in a strange time where heroes are treated like sinners and sinners are treated like saints.
True, very true. Karin, yes, the Mandela question is interesting. I think for the time, and if your intention was to move over to a one-party state, I think Nelson Mandela was the proper person for it. He was a bit of a diversion, I suppose, a lightning conductor, let's call it that. It could have turned out badly. You needed a guy like Nelson Mandela. I had the honor to meet him with my family, and he was a gentleman. He was very old by then. He had hard of hearing as well. I came there to speak to him about politics, but the half an hour I had, he insisted on speaking about theology, which is a lovely subject, and I would have liked to discuss that, but it's not what I was there for. But then, to be objective, Nelson Mandela was a terrorist responsible for about 18 of the bombs in the 80s. I go to those places still where those bombs exploded and took the lives of black and white people. They were a terrorist movement, and today they actually still react like a terrorist movement. There's lots of good to be said about Nelson Mandela, but if you're truly objective, you'll find there's a lot of vice there as well. The decay of South Africa started on his beat. The farm murders started on his beat, and he said nothing. He was too busy acting as the number one photo opportunity in the world.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well said, Steve. We're going to come back to you, Steve. I just want to say, Ed, lovely for you to be with us. Give us a little bit about your background and how obviously you came to be on this journey communicating about the Boer cause.
Well, I've kind of been on the underground music scene in America for a number of years. And so you got your mainstream and you got your underground scene. But the underground scene is actually a pretty popular scene too in America. And so I was, make a long story short, I met a guy who started producing my songs or doing radio promotion of my songs, and he was a South African. His name is Franz Moritz, and he's from Wild Horse Radio. It was one of his, like, internet stations, but he was getting us played on about 5,000 or 6,000 different radio stations, and he had a link on his page. It said farmmurders.com or something like that, and I clicked on it, and then I contacted him back. I was like, is this stuff really going on in South Africa? And it's been many, many years ago. I've been doing this now for so many years, so it's been at least 10 years ago that I noticed this link, and he was like, yes, this is going on. And I was like, well, we got to do something about it. And me being naive, I'm like, with me being an American, being in a band, doing the things I do, I could probably really expose it pretty quick. But, you know, it's been a hard thing to expose. So I geared my band for doing shows. I would call them Boer Rights shows. And people would show up. I would put Boer show. And people would show up thinking there'd be some kind of pig roast. And nothing against my own countrymen. They're just very ignorant. Most of them didn't even realize there was white people that lived in Africa. You know what I mean? They're that ignorant to the subject that they didn't even realize there was white Africans. So the whole shows were geared with exposing, you know, that there was farmers being murdered, that there is white Africans, they're being disenfranchised. And we did it for a number of years. And then in 2014, people kept asking me, would you, really stand up and fight for this cause? And I got to thinking, I was like, well, yeah, I can. You know, I used to be a professional fighter, so I came back out of retirement. I trained, and I came back, and I fought a fight, you know what I mean, for the Boers. The guy that was promoting, that was supposed to donate money for a cause, he backed out after all the money was gathered. You know how that works. He disappeared. I wound up paying out of my pocket, so I fought. I paid out of my pocket, you know, for a donation. And I wound up winning the fight, which was amazing, after 10 years out of the ring. And I beat a 22-year-old MMA heavyweight champion out of Indiana. And it was more of, I didn't think I would win when I decided to do this. It was more, I thought I would take a good whipping, showing that, you know what I mean? As long as you stand up for something good, and it don't matter if you win or lose. But luckily I wound up, you know, winning, you know. But in this underground scene, there's so many great artists too. There's Waylon Jennings' grandson, Way Jennings. He's one of the artists that's out there right now in the underground scene. His father, Terry Jennings, and he just came out of a book. It's called Tales of My Outlaw Father. So, I mean, there's a lot of big name people that's in the underground scene that you don't hear about, you know, in the mainstream. Another one's a good buddy of mine. He actually offered me a job, and he just got done touring Ireland. But he offered me a job playing bass for him, and his name's Billy Payne. He's like Steve. He's just one of those great, nice guys. So it's the underground scene has been really good to me. I made a living out of it for years, you know what I mean? So, but I geared my entire band, Tattoo Billy, for exposing genocide in South Africa, and it cost me. My father in 2014, after the fight, my father passed away of brain cancer. My wife passed away at the same time I was preparing this fight. And they were going to cancel the fight. And I was like, no. I was like, I've done trained for this, and I'm going to do this. People are expecting me to do this. And I followed through. But it's been just a great run. I mean, something I was running for. I got to meet Steve up in Chicago. He got to meet my wife. You know, at that time it passed away. I'm remarried now to a great lady. She usually fixes me up for stuff like this, but she had to work today, so I hope I did pretty good by myself. But Steve was great. He's one of the, I could say this, I've seen a lot of artists. I've opened up for a lot of big artists over the years, and Steve was the nicest and one of the best performers I've seen musically live. And I mean, he could play Vegas or he could do rock. I mean, he's just a huge genre. And I like to see him do some of his great songs in English, because I just think he would really take off over here in America. But it's been just a great thing, you know, being involved in this. And like Steve said too about apartheid, the one thing you can say about apartheid that is different than segregation is segregation in America was more racial, as in apartheid, I look at it as more tribal. I mean, if you get too many, like if Zulus get around certain tribes, they start killing each other. That's what I explain to a lot of people. You can't put an African concept in a Western world concept, too. So that's always been one of the things I said. You can't, you know. And the other thing I'm a proponent on, I believe to see a republic in South Africa that's united for all races. But I am a firm believer for a Boer land, a Boer republic, too. And it's one of the things I've always believed in. If the Zulu can have a land for Zulus, I believe Boer should have a land for Boer.
Absolutely, Ed. So,
and I've had a lot of great people support me in South Africa, not only Karen Smith and you, Mel B, but the Lamprick family, Nikki Lamprick, and Court Boffa. He comes over and sees me here in America once a year. I met him through doing this, and he's came all the way from Australia. He's an Aussie Connor that comes over and sees me every year, stays with me for a week. He's a great guy. Another guy that bought all of Tattoo Billy stuff is Ryan Guinness. And the DePoy family, they've always supported me over these years. And a couple guys today, as soon as we posted, it was Cobus Boffa and Heine Lawrence that were like hey, we're going to be listening in to this today. So this is great stuff. It's starting a side project right now with a great friend and his brother named Scott Ramsey. It's called Digital Cowboys because Tattoo Billy had been so politicized over the years, it's hard for us to get out and play anymore. So our shows are very seldom because we're so stigmatized with the boar issue and the farm murders. So we've started a side project to try to get out and be playing out more often than what we have been doing.
Thanks very much, Ed. I'd just like to tell our audience that the song that we played into the show with the intro music was Steve's latest hit called Fierce Lit. And very
my favorite song right now.
Absolutely. very appropriate for this occasion. And as a tribute to the mixture between South Africans and Americans, our producer is now going to play for us one of Steve's songs, Rhinestone Cowboy.
Yep, that's a good one. I got that album.
It joins the two countries together.
I've been walking these streets so long, singing the same old song. I know every crack in these dirty sidewalks of Broadway. Hustle is the name of the game, and nice guys get washed away like snow in the rain. There's been a load of compromising on the road to my horizon, and I'm gonna be where the lights are shining on me like a rhinestone cowboy. Riding out on a horse in a star-spangled rodeo, like a rhinestone cowboy. Getting cards and letters from people I don't even know, and offers coming over the phone. Smile can hide all the pain, but you're down when you're riding the train that's taking the long way. And I dream of the things I do, with a subway token and a dollar tucked inside my shoe. There'll be a load of compromising on the road to my horizon. I'm gonna be where the lights are shining on me, like a rhinestone cowboy. Riding out on a horse in a star-spangled rodeo, like a rhinestone cowboy. Getting cards and letters
or Karin.
Steve, you were saying during that piece of music how pleased you were that we chose that particular piece. So explain why.
Apart from the original CDs that I've made, I'd like to pay tribute to the artist that I grew up with, in the house with, so to speak. So the two I mentioned earlier on, I did a massive tribute concert to Chris Christopherson. I had the honor to meet him as well. And then I did two tribute CDs to Neil Diamond, and I also came to see him in Los Angeles. So I'm a big fan. I will always be a big fan. Two years ago, I released a country CD of some of my favorite country songs. And two of the songs that I chose on there was Gypsy Woman by Don Williams and Rhinestone Cowboy by Glen Campbell, two of my very favorite songs that played in our house as a young boy. And ironically, 2 years into the tour, both those gentlemen passed away. So the tour became a tribute to them as well. I'm also a big fan of Bob Seger and these guys. I know Bob Seger as well. So I know he's still alive. And I'm going to, if I can get hold of him, if you guys can get hold of him, ask him to please stick around for much longer because I love him to death.
Oh, brilliant, brilliant. I want to talk a little bit more about the work that you've been doing to raise awareness about what's going on in South Africa and how it affects you and your music career.
About 12 years ago, a decade ago when I started viewing this, it was right in the middle of the liberal madness that you cannot have things like tribes, you cannot have things like individual nations, you can only be one nation, you can only have one language, one monetary unit, one slogan, one anthem, one flag. And I don't know why the left thought that would work. Isn't it strange that a decade later the left is actually the opposite? They still have that thing that we should all fight for becoming this one nation. I think that what they think is it will relinquish us from wars. But I think it will draw us to wars if you deny the individual groups and tribes and nations out there. What you need is tolerance of differences. You don't need to change everybody to become this wonderful consensual monster because it's not going to work. So 10 years ago when I counted the foul murders, I realized that there's a bit of a discrepancy there. Something doesn't sound right. The moment the police realized that I need to tell you the basis of our whole debate or chat that we're going to have here, is that in Australia and New Zealand, when the cultures clashed, the incoming colonial culture became the majority group. This is the one thing that did not happen in South Africa. So I can keep asking Australians, Americans, and people all over the world, really, who are, you know, who run their own nation states. Can you imagine waking up as a minority in your own country one morning? How would that feel when you say goodbye to the things that you have no idea how many debates I have about keeping Afrikaans, the language, with English people? But English folk have no fear of losing their language. I don't think English folk understand what it's like to lose an English university or school. So I just need to tell you that again, that when we have race debates in South Africa, I need you to know that pigmentation per se doesn't bother me that much. I'm not a great biological determinist. I believe all nations can manage everything. I do believe that not all nations did. That is the one difference. The second thing and problem we have in South Africa is that cultural differences do fall in along racial lines. So I can be called for almost a racist for almost anything, even if I don't have pigmentation in mind, even if I say that culture habitually or collectively do this kind of thing, you will be called a racist because I did not mean white people, I meant black people. So it's a very, very sensitive thing in South Africa. Apart from that, we have massive black therapy, and I can't understand that because the black friends and colleagues that I have really don't need the therapy. They're good enough to stand on their own legs and get up. You know, we don't have Jason Riley. This is, I don't know if you can see that in this back to front, but Jason Riley is one of your anti-black economic empowerment activists in America, and he wrote this book asking the question, how liberals make it harder for blacks to succeed. But we have blacks like that as well, very few, who are not interested in the nanny state. They're not interested in standing around like this begging for more. Of course, you can see now why Marxism and socialism will be extremely popular at the southernmost point in Africa, because firstly, we're cut off from the rest of the continent, where none of the developing nations benefited from socialism. But we feel down here we can still do it. We can still rewrite the whole Marxist theory, which is a strange thing. I do not believe that blacks should be treated like that. I treat black people as equals. I do not treat them as lesser beings. That's why I am against the nanny state. Their government and the government they keep in power is for the nanny state. And I don't know what the question was, but I'm trying to sketch to you how confusing it is that when you start fighting for your culture, even as an artist and writing songs about your culture, and when your culture is attacked and they become a victim and you mention that, how you are seen as a racist, and the moment you are seen as a racist in this country, you're damned. That's pretty much the end of you. The only reason I have survived and survived fairly well is because my people seem to flock close, they seem to mobilize closer to me. I did for a while believe the liberal myth that we were a small group, a small little marginalized group that don't mean anything. But I'll have you know that the concerts are huge. I now travel the world to see South African diaspora there. They are predominantly my people. I place the photographs from stage so people can see that if you think we are a small minority, you may be wrong. We may be a minority, but we could be quite big. In the European Parliament, I had the opportunity to make a speech, and I was surrounded by 50 stateless nations, the leaders of 50 stateless nations. You can chew through that one a little bit. That means we could be a majority of minorities. The people who are being ruled by people they don't like could be the majority population in the world. And I side with them. Now, we are completely cut off from South Africa. America and Europe and Donald Trump seem to have their own problems. I don't think it's going to be like the old days where we can beg the world to look at South Africa again because we're important, because we're not important to the world. The world has walked away. They've completed their integration project down there at the bottom of Africa. They walked away 30 years ago, and since then this place has fallen, decayed completely. It's not even a secret anymore of what happens to this country. So when I start nitpicking the things that are happening in the new South Africa that are not an improvement on the old South Africa, you can understand why some people call me an apartheid apologist, which I don't think I am. I got shows cancelled only by one or two people, but they seem to cover contact the world, wherever there are shows in the world, in Canada or in Australia. This gentleman from Holland, a South African expat, would phone them and say that, watch out, Hitler is coming to do a concert in your venue. And of course, if you're in Canada or Australia and you hear that, you don't even question it. You just close down the concert and walk away. So far, we never had to lose a concert, at least. We've only had to postpone concerts and move to other venues. Mel, you'll remember the one in Holland, which was only a talk, actually. It was me and a politician having a chat, like we're having right now. That same gentleman in Amsterdam phoned the venue owners and said that a very dangerous person, a radical person is coming, an extremist is coming to speak at your venue. And of course, they closed that down as well. So we went to another venue. Needless to say, things have changed in the last 3 years. That same politician that invited me is now the opposition in Holland. The conservative parties have grown in Holland. The Republicans and the people who'd like to just take a step back and breathe. That's all that conservatism is. It's a cautiousness. And this is the time to be cautious. Apart from that, I'm quite classically liberal. And when we have chats about other things, you'll see why I say that. But in my country, I cannot afford to be a classical liberal. I have to be conservative and hang on for dear life to everything that will be ripped away from you, even violently. And I'm not just speaking about monuments, I'm speaking about lives. We are now facing probably a record murder rate in South Africa and farm murder attack rate. I actually have the last 11 months stats right in front of me. Let me just see if I can open it up. It is just incredible what the stats look like this year. I'll find it in a second. I want to show you the attacks and the murders. I predicted we will reach 100 murders, farm murders this year, and probably get close to 400 or 500 farm attacks this year.
That's only the farms. That is not the urban people.
You're right.
You know, we can quantify the farms because they are well documented. Whereas those who die in the cities, their death certificate often says natural causes, although they were stabbed, raped, whatever, you know. But that is only farmers, of which you only have 35,000 odd left.
That's correct. That's correct. And the problem with the cities is they have stopped giving us stats in color, in skin color. I see America still does it. Well, they can't afford to do it here, of course, because it'll be a massive embarrassment for the people who think that the liberal project is actually working. So they won't do that. Now, you can say out on the farms, you know, you get black and white farmers as well. But I am counting the graves of the commercial farmer, and 90% even more of commercial farmers are my people. They are not subsistence farmers. They make food for the country. They don't own a chicken and a tree. They own more than that, and they make food wider. So when you hear me speak about farm murders, I will always mention commercial farmers. And it is the commercial farmer, the predominantly white commercial farmer, that reported on that Monday, that incredible Monday, Black Monday of a month or two ago, where after 12 years of begging people to arrive at these protest marches, South Africa did it by themselves. Almost every town, the farmers came from their farms, they took their vehicles, they joined up with others, they showed a sign of unity and got together and say, we're in this together, we got to get out of this together, and it doesn't seem the government is going to help us. What we are not allowed to say, let me tell you what we are allowed to say. We are allowed to say that we are losing so many victims to farm murders, and so many whites have been killed, and so many commercial farmers have been killed. What we are not allowed to say is, who are they being killed by? Now, that is taboo. You cannot say who they are being attacked by. They are being attacked by a person or a South African. But the moment, of course, that there is a white transgression, which you do get, of course, that'll be front page news. I'm sure you'll know about Oscar Pistorius, you know, the Zalta murders. The moment they get them, the liberal media jumps on them to show the world that there's an equal murder rate, perpetrator rate out there, but we know the truth is harsh.
And Steve, if the newspaper reports on it, it's always a white pair of hands in the handcuffs. Always.
Because we won't complain. If you put black hands in the handcuffs, they will complain, even though that it's quite accurate and it's quite valid, you know.
That is there again, fake news, because they are literally telling you it was a white person who did the murder. And it in 9 out of 10 cases, 9.9 out of 10 cases, it's not true. But the newspapers portray that for everybody to see. And it makes me very ill.
Yeah. Black people hold to the claim, of course, that the murders are proportionate, which means if they are 80% of the nation, 80% of the murders, you know, should be them, and 10% of the murders should be white, of course. But it's difficult to count. Like I said, the police don't give us the stats in pigmentation, in pallor. So we only believe that. But if you count actual incarcerations, now that one you can't miss and you can't avoid, because incarcerations, I wonder if 1% or maybe 1.5% of the incarcerations of all the crimes we've mentioned now are white. The same kind of thing is exposed in America. Easier, because you do keep the stats. The FBI don't seem to be shy about calling murders and perpetrators and victims by their skin color. In South Africa, it's taboo, of course, because what are we doing? We're fabricating the perfect society the world tried to force us into 30 years ago, and we have failed miserably. It's a bit of a life-saving process out there. It's saving the egos of black people. Like I said, I know enough black people who don't need that, but it's... South Africa is not a civilization building project. South Africa is a black therapy rehabilitation center.
Yeah. And that in itself, Steve, is racist. Black on black racism by telling your fellow people that they are incompetent, unable to look after themselves. The state has to take care of the minority whites, owe them a living, owe them money, owe them the farm, owe them. That is racist in the extreme, telling a bunch of people that they're useless.
It is worse than that. It's hate speech. And some of the most popular, in fact, pretty much all the parties have policies. And some of the most important policies of these parties is, for instance, the land grab policy, that there must be land distribution. Now you ask us, the moment you've painted that target on the farmer's back, how is it possible that you cannot have a staggering farm at a rate, the one we have? Because you've painted the target on their backs. The moment you say anybody owes something from the past, you're painting a target on their back in our country. You know, and the murders are not normal murders, if you get a thing like a normal murder. Our murders are just the most unconventional murders. They only happen during genocides. That's why we keep calling it genocide. It's not the amount of murders. It is the type of murder. And I've stood with children. I've held their hands in the court cases. I've sat with them with my arms around them. And the perpetrators would turn around and they would laugh at us. Because 6 months ago, when those children, they were 17, 18 years old, the specific case that I attended, they were having a barbecue, as we do in South Africa. The four black guys jumped over the fence and tied everybody up, the three girls and their boyfriends. Then they raped the girls in front of the guys. Then they would carry on eating. They would carry on eating from the barbecue. They would do that for 6 hours until there's almost nothing left of humans or humanity. Those guys jumped the fence again and harassed elderlies down the road, back to their vehicle, and bragged so much about it that they inevitably did get caught. Those are the people that 5 meters from you in the court hall stand up, turn around and laugh at you, because this is a soft landing. Our constitution is a soft landing for criminals, and you can't make things better that way. And of course, the prevailing cloud in the air that says those people, those girls, those, that race deserves it.
Oh.
That's the kind of atmosphere that we're trying to create. A nice South African, it's not going to happen.
But Steve, they stand up in court and say, I did it because they were white. And they say it quite blatantly and they get away with it. Because as I understand the figures, maybe 13% of perpetrators actually make it to court.
Yeah, yeah, we don't have a very good, we don't have a lot of success in catching our murders.
Yes.
In fact, we have our hands full. The long arm of the law here is about... miles too short. It's not gonna solve it. Yeah. Also written against the walls were the blood of the victims. They write there. You can imagine what they write there about the women. But you are right. Almost every case that we read about, when they ask why, many of the answers is because they're white. You know, because we can.
Yeah.
It's a terrible thing. 4 years ago, I had the honor of saying yes or no to act in a movie about farm murders. And we all knew that would be quite a calling. It's a bit of a loaded thing the moment you say yes to that kind of thing. We tried to make an objective as possible movie called Triergrond, which means land of mourning. And in the movie, we try also show up, we did have the white family get murdered by black perpetrators. But in the movie, we try to show how it affects everybody, starting with the family under the roof, the mother, the father, and the children, going to the workers, who very often we love very much, and they love us, and they are not the murderers, often to the workers, some small percentage of the workers sometimes take part in these murders. And then it's the side, everybody on the outside. From there, they come from anywhere, from other towns, they come from other countries to murder us. How everybody is affected by the farmer. As one farmer goes, he is probably employing 100 or 150 people, and they send money to their families out there, wherever they may be. It is devastating to fall from 120,000 farmers in the 80s to 30,000, 35,000, as you mentioned, in 2017.
And I understand of those, 20,000 of those farms are on the market in the desperate hopes that they can sell them before the redistribution without compensation becomes law. And yet, Steve, I have to tell you this. I read it this morning. We have been writing to our congressman. We've been writing to President Trump. We've been writing. We had a whole campaign last year, emailing Congress once a month. We'd update the South African story and email them. Nobody got a response. The whole year, the entire team of us didn't even get an acknowledgement that they'd received our emails. So this year we decided to do a snail mail and if possible, register your letter so you know it's been delivered.
Yeah.
Well, one of our guys sent it to his congressman and he got a reply yesterday. And the reply was, that this is normal crime, as you've just said. This is normal crime in South Africa. There is no such thing as the farm murders. They're keeping an eye on it. But as far as they can see, this is Congress, yeah?
Yeah.
No such thing, really. There doesn't seem to be a bigger number. The same thing you just said, the numbers are even, you know, 80% blacks get murdered.
Yeah.
And, thank you very much for contacting me. We'll keep an eye on it. In other words, don't bother me again because you're lying about this whole story. And
that,
together with the Canadian family, the South African family have just been deported from Canada because in their asylum application, the Canadians decided that you're using racism and apartheid stuff to plead your case and there's no such thing going in South Africa. So you go home and get murdered.
That's the world's attitude towards this. Yeah, that is the world's attitude. The EU also said it will not be prioritized, the discussion of farm murders in South Africa. It's amazing that they see it as normal when our murder rate has leapt from something like 15 or 20,000 to now this year 34.1 out of 100,000. I don't know how that is normal. Maybe it's easy in America to say this because what is your murder rate? Is it 4 out of 100,000? Europe is about 2 out of 100,000. The countries of my ancestors, which is Germany and Holland, is 1 or 2 out of 100,000. Australia is 1 out of 100,000. Canada is probably 1 or 2 out of 100,000. We are 34.1 out of 100,000 is our murder rate per year. But our farmers are 150. And I'm going to err on the conservative side because they say I inflate these figures. I don't know why I would do that, but maybe an inflated figure will get a better response from the police. But 150 out of 100,000, I'm not sure what is normal about that. You know, the most devastating murder rates of the most devastating murderous countries are probably Honduras and Venezuela and those, you know, and they run about 100 out of 100,000. Our farmers are being wiped out at 150 out of 100,000 murders. I got it right here in front of me if I can read it to you. These are the farm attacks from the 1st of January 2017 to the 30th of November. That's about the most recent murder stats we have. That is 424 farm attacks, which means 1.3 farm murder attacks per day, farm attacks per day. And that's 84 farm murders up to the 30th of November. That figure is already old. But that's one farmer that is murdered every 3.9 days. Now, when I said there was a farmer murdered once a week, I was castigated. I was punished for daring to say a thing like that. Africa checked and these guys deconstructed all my statistics. Mm-hmm. We are being murdered at now officially at 3.9 murders, one murder every 3.9 days.
Two a week. And we have to keep on stressing that it's farmers only. That is not the total white murders. That is just farmers.
Yeah, that's just the farmer, the commercial farmer. We even have on which day farm attacks are likely to happen, and that is on a Thursday night. It seems like 17% of the murders take place. There's the average number of attackers, three. They come between 3 and 12 are the groups that they come with. There is no way that you can resist that even if you are armed. Of course, the government has made sure that they disarmed us quite long ago. Some farmers out there are still armed, but it's of no avail. You know, you can't resist 10 people with AK-47s. Disarming a nation could be positive for the nation, but then everybody has to play together. You know, there is no better house to rob and to rape than an unarmed house when you come with the weapons.
And Steve, you know, really, this normal crime story is absolute rubbish, because you get 4 or 5 or 8 fit, healthy, young people attack an 82-year-old bedridden grandmother.
That's right. That's right.
What threat is she to 8 full-grown adult males? She's no threat whatsoever. And then carve a cross in her face and stick a assegai down her throat. Normal crime.
Yeah. Normal. No, there's nothing normal about it. I will not stand for that at all. I have lost family members and they've all been octogenarian. That's the kind of coward you sit with here, you know. They do not go for the younger guys. They go for mothers, children, and the elderlies. Yeah. They are out there. They are defenseless. They are out there on the farms. They prefer drowning. They burn them with hot irons and they drill holes into them, you know, whatever tools they have available. They make it as messy as possible. I will die screaming that this is not normal. I think one day in history, maybe the world will look back in shame that they, during a time when the apartheid murder rate was completely insignificant compared to what we have now, the world was screaming crime against humanity. Now that we have actual crimes where blood flows, the world is walking away. And that you're getting the kind of correspondence that you're getting. We get that as well when we knock on the doors. We can't solve it internally because our government doesn't care. Our government prioritized farm murders 2 years ago. If anything that happened is the farm murders increased. So no, we have to knock on the doors of people out there. We pray that somebody will hear somewhere along the line. But it does seem that the world is besieged by their own problems. You know, Donald Trump is making America great again. I don't think he's much concerned, as concerned as the liberal presidents were back in the 60s and the 70s.
I think it's more ignorance. I don't say on the part of governments, because they know. They have embassies in your country. They know. So no, not on their part, but on the part of the people themselves. It's the media blackout and therefore ignorance on their part, because when we speak out, people are stunned, Steve. They are absolutely, as Ed said, my husband, he's an American and he loves to tell people he's married to an African-American because he's a good old biker boy, you know, and people don't. Really? And then they meet me. They didn't know they were white Africans. It's the truth. They do.
Yeah, no, they don't.
No. And since 1994, South Africa has fallen off the map altogether. So nobody knows. And when people like Mel, myself, Ed, yourself speak out, they're stunned. People are sympathetic. But governments, I don't know. They're the only ones who can actually make something happen, because I can't bring 2,000 people to South Africa to help. You know, the government has to turn an eye and say, Mr. Zuma, this is not good enough. Singing Kill the Boer is not acceptable. And somebody has to tell him that.
Yeah. That's one of the definitions. One of the tenets of genocide, of course, is that it must be an organized thing. But we don't need that. We have a president who sings "Bring Me My Machine Gun." He sang it last night, and he also sings "Kill the Boers; They Are Rapists," which is not just hate speech; it's also wrong. They're not committing the rapes out there, are they? They're too busy farming and getting food for this poor nation. Yeah, last year I suggested, politically correct, that we should get sector policing, get burglar bars, you know, work on your fences and your gates, get your two-way radios. But this year, I'm afraid you have to arm yourself. This year, get a weapon, get a gun. Imagine the luxury of having a gun-free society in South Africa. It'll be devastating. Get a gun. Get a dog. Get a lot of dogs. Because if you're out there, you are in trouble. Get a lion. Get a lion if you can. It is incredible. So,
if I may just correct here quickly, Steve, you mentioned something earlier that was of great interest, and I do want to draw this comparison since we do have an international audience here. You mentioned, imagine if people in America and say, Australia woke up and suddenly, you know, the the colonial settlers, they weren't the majority anymore. They were, in fact, the minority, and they were being suppressed. How would they feel? But what people in America and Australia sometimes seem to forget, you know, Ed, you can attest to this, is that the colonialists in America went and genocided 100 million of the Native Americans there to get to the point where they are the majority. And that didn't happen in South Africa. I mean, I'm not saying that there weren't people killed during the apartheid era, but certainly not to the extent that you see going on. I mean, in Australia, they went and genocided off an entire island of mainland Aboriginals. And these policies were praised. I mean, there's still artwork out there going, old American Indian art was going, the only good Indian is a dead Indian. And that was the kind of mantras that were going around during the cowboy Western times, was that these people were just to be killed. They were pests. They were pestilent. In fact, in the 1960s, when people like Verwoerd were giving the natives of South Africa their own self-governing homelands, the Aborigines in Australia weren't even considered as human beings in the national census. They were counted as fauna and flora, seen as lower than animals. They were counted as plant life, not even recognized as human beings. So, you know, in a certain respect, these people actually don't realize that the atrocities that have gone on to keep their sort of majority in power, okay, and the things that are that has been done in the past, all right, and now they're sitting in a situation where they are being completely ignorant to the fact that is now happening to South Africa, but in a reverse paradox situation. So I was wondering what you thought about that.
Yeah, the opposite evidence on Africa, our problem was the black population explosion, not the wiping out of the nations. Well, we were always outnumbered by them. There was not a single war that white people were involved in against not just the British, but any black tribes, that where my people were ever the majority. So this is where our arguments split, you know, between yours and ours, that the whites in America were the majorities. Also in Australia, they were the majorities. We have a different thing. I don't engage majority groups in discussions about minority rights, I stick to that. The one thing that Verwoerd could not combat, and he also calculated it wrongly, was the future. He projected wrongly how many black people there were. He thought there would be a lot, but the explosion was incredible. So no, calling for a genocide there is probably not going to do it. I want to tell you that we shouldn't jump between apartheid and the 18th century and the 17th century. There were atrocities in those periods, but they all differed slightly. And a different day has a different context and a different time. I don't hold it against Jesus that he didn't say anything against slavery. He didn't, because at the time, slavery was kind of, you know, riding a motorbike. It was kind of there, it upset certain people, but it was kind of seen as the norm. So the French say autre temps, autre mousse, which means that a different day in a different way, a different habit for a different time. So the struggle with historical context is indispensable, and it's essential, because the French say that thing, and today you can either be compensated for something that far back, but then you have to tell us how far back would you like to be compensated for, because I can take you back a little bit further, and eventually we'll all end up with a slave as an ancestor. What will we get for that? You'll get nothing for that. So I am against any form of compensation. So when blacks writing for compensation or reparation for historical indiscrepancies, what they are saying is they are vouching, firstly, that their ancestors would never have done it.
Yeah.
Would not have used superior technology to travel, to fight, and to conquer in an age of conquest. And that's a lie. Nobody can promise that about their ancestors. They were outdone in a period when being outdone was detrimental to your future. That was the age of conquest. During apartheid, of course, it was way past the age of conquest. Nobody conquered each other during apartheid. It wasn't like that. There were atrocities during apartheid. And as a human rights aware person, I cannot okay that under any circumstances ever. I don't care if only five black people died. It was the way that they were treated that we died. But then again, I'm doing it through the moral lenses of 2017. That is not the way to do it. Henrik Verwoerd was a child of his time. There was some criticism towards what he was doing, but he was worldly. or worldwide acknowledged as a very great statesman. I think it was in the Time magazine, and there was a lot of criticism for what he was doing. But only because of the rest of the world and the liberals with a post-Second World War guilt complex, we shouldn't do that again. And I think that's what, I think the liberal intention is right. We shouldn't have world wars again, but it's not done by eradicating borders. That's not how you're going to get it right.
Good point. Is it time for another musical interlude? Should I ask our producer to play something? Or are you going to play something for us, Steve?
Yes, please.
No, play something else there. I'm still warming up here.
All right.
I'm good.
What songs have you got?
I'm not sure what our producer has got lined up. He'll just surprise us, I guess.
When your baby leaves you all alone and nobody calls you on the phone, don't you feel like crying? Don't you feel like crying? Come on, cry to me. When you're all alone in your lonely room and there's nothing but the smell of perfume, don't you feel like crying? Don't you feel like crying? Loneliness is such a waste of time. And I know you never have to walk alone. You can take my hand, babe. Walk with me. Listen, when you're waiting for a voice to come in the midnight, and there is no one, don't you feel I cry? Don't you feel I cry? Take my hand, walk with me. When you're waiting for a voice to come late in the midnight hour, and there's no one, don't you feel like crying?
Come on, cry to me.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Biggie. It was awesome. And we obviously would love to get a little bit back more into this. So, Karin, you had a few points you wanted to get discussing.
Yes. I'd like to say that, again, that South Africans are extremely resilient, and they will rise up and beat anything brought against them. And I'm not talking about fighting, although they've proven themselves good at that in the past as well. During sanctions, we made petrol out of coal. We produced the best military equipment in the world. We had countries trying to break the sanctions to come and buy them from us. We did the first heart transplant in the world. We've recently done an incredible operation. We are resilient people. And Steve is the epitome of the musical part of that, because we had very little that we were allowed to listen to. So we sat around our radios and listened to, because we didn't get TV until the 70s. So we'd sit around our radios and listen to Skellum, LM Radio. Do you hear me? That we were not allowed in our country. Do you remember that, Steve?
I do remember that. I do remember that, yeah.
And that was where international music from.
And the radio was hidden underneath the pillow so that your parents didn't know that you were listening to LM Radio. LM Radio still exists today, by the way. They revived the station and it's playing great music, but it's from Mozambique, of course, still from Mozambique.
Yeah. But I mean, that was unchristian music, rock and roll and Elvis Presley and all those terrible unchristian things that we were not allowed to have. But I will say this, we were very protected from bad things that were happening under the apartheid era. We were very protected. We were allowed to be kids. We were allowed to play. We didn't have the influence from the outside world. So although there were a lot of things we didn't get because of sanctions, we didn't suffer for it because we made our own way of life. It made us stronger people. It made us more patriotic. It made us more aware of who we were. And that is where your music comes in, Steve, because it's been part of my life for a very, very long time. And when Americans ask me, so what music do you like? Well, I'm in the right place. In Texas, I love country music because that was very much a South African thing. You say you're not a country singer, but your music tends that way.
Oh, yes.
You know, we had Ballyhoo, for instance. Nobody knows who that is today.
I remember them.
Yes.
Oh, is that so?
Yes. I went out with one of the guys from Ballyhoo. So, you know, we had our own brand of everything.
Yeah.
And I'm proud of that. Very proud that we stood up and did it our way.
Yeah, no, for sure.
Play that song. You should sing that song because it's true of South Africans. We did it all. And your music is a product, an end result of not being exposed to things, listening to it under the blankets at night, what you were. And it is unique in a lot of ways, Steve.
Well, thank you very much. Well, firstly, I'm a poet of the nation, so I live with my ear on their hearts. When the nation cries, I cry. When the nation laughs, I laugh. I'm a better Afrikaner than a South African. I don't believe there is a thing like a South African, unless it's a territorial area at the bottom of Africa. We're all from there. But, you know, we have 11 different languages, many, many different cultures, and very few of them agree on anything. But, yes, I'm still a proud South African as well when it comes to sports anyway. Culturally, I'm a Boer, an Afrikaner. I understand that. I've always said Sweet Caroline is probably more an Afrikaans song than an English song because we love English music. We love country music. Only recently did Afrikaans really cross over to sounding powerful, real, the genre of country. But the country scene was massive in the 70s. If you recall names like Lance James, Clive Bruce, and all the Billies and the Tommies. And you should listen to this. I had a wonderful project in the year 2002. I came across an idea. I thought and anybody in the world can do this. I thought, I'm going to record the greatest country hits that ever came from my country. Most of them were original country songs. Most of the artists were 80 years old. Some were younger, 70, but most of them had really stopped singing. So what I did is I would record a CD of these songs, and I would go fetch them to sing at least one verse of that song with me. So you'd be hearing the original song sung by me, but in the third verse or in the chorus there, Al Debo comes in and he sings Hasi Hukumasyo Statukort. Or I'll get Lance James and he sings Donkey. Or I'll get Bobby Angel and he sang hold on, I've got the guitar right here. Bobby Angel's big song went like this. Long ago and far away, in my old common labor shoes, I would get him and he'd sing the third verse with me. That CD we called Tuka, which means from long time ago, and it became the number one selling CD in South Africa that year. And I made a Tuka 2 and I made a Tuka 3, getting all the old artists to come out of wherever they're hiding in their nursing homes to come out and come sing their songs again. So hey, there's an idea for you out there if you're interested. Let's get the old guys who probably aren't that busy anymore to come do a verse of their own song. And those songs were predominantly country songs. So I would do anything from Glynis Lynn, Ford Jackson, a Jill, Master Jack, you know those songs. If you're a South African, you remember them very well. Not all the songs were local songs. Some of the songs were widely known all over the world, but they were also a hit for a South African singer in South Africa, and I would cover that song again. So yeah, that's what's from there onwards, I was seen as a country singer, and I proudly say, yeah, I've got the hat, I got the belt, I got the boots. You can call me anything you want. Just give me the guitar. And I really love the country music that came from that.
And then I'd like to talk to you a bit about activism, because you said you have a platform and you have a voice, and therefore you feel that it was a natural path to follow. And Sunette Bridges went the same way. And I admire both of you. Because, Steve, you've lost so much by standing up. You kind of glossed over it when you were talking earlier. You don't like to make a personal issue of it, but I've seen that they tried to stop you singing in New Zealand. They're now trying to ban you from Namibia. You lost big, big South African festivals where they would not have you because of, racist, whatever the reasons were. And it must have hit you financially, being banned and having your music banned. I know from Sunette how that hurt her pocket, yeah. And how it hurts your ability to help your people. So you pay a very heavy price for speaking out. And that's probably why people don't want to do it, because they're not prepared to lose their income. But you did.
Yeah.
And it must have hurt.
No, it should have. It should have. By 2015, I thought it was probably the end of my career. I had to let go most of the people who worked for me. You'll remember that a few months before that, I sang Die Stem, which was the former South African anthem. I sang at a concert called Unie Bos, and there were 50,000 people that night, and all of them stood up and sang the song with me. But of course, it's not the public is not the problem. The public never boycotted me. It was the organizations, the sponsors, yeah, the people out there who make the show happen. So for them, it was the evilest thing in the world to do, is to sing the old South African anthem, which was actually a poem written in the 1920s, a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful prayer written by Celia Langenhoven. And many years later, they did put a tune to it, and it became the apartheid anthem, if you want to call it that. Of course, there's not a word of skin color or anything. It's just a prayer and gratitude towards a country. Pretty much like the American anthem. But of course, people need the symbols, you know, so they had to change the song. Nelson Mandela thought it well to not throw away the old anthem. He actually kept a part of it. So today we sing a bit of a mishmash of an anthem of different languages, and it ends up in the Afrikaans and English version of that very anthem. But the fact that I sang the entire anthem, of course, is a different context, and people saw it as someone being nostalgic about the old South Africa. And I'm not sure why I'm not allowed to be nostalgic about any part of history that I really want to be nostalgic about. So by a year later, I was in big trouble. I had lost pretty much all the big contracts, all the big, you know, all the great casinos. They are great venues for us artists. Well, those casinos boycotted me as well. The biggest show in South Africa is called Afrikaans is Groot, which is translated to Afrikaans is Great, the language. And we do a concert in which we sing in that language. And that happens to be so loyally supported that it's become the biggest concert in South Africa. 80,000 people come and see it every year. We just had our 10th one. Well, all those sponsors pulled out and they said they will only come back unless Steve Hofmeyr is fired. Yeah. So you must understand what situation that puts you in, especially with your colleagues. At that stage, if I asked many of my colleagues, what do you think, they would say, you better leave because we need the money. So I had to fire a few people. It broke my heart. I had some of my best friends working for me. But I just got married again, and we were trying for a little baby, and I just had to rethink the whole thing. For some other reason during my career, the people, the public out there, the people that I profess to sing for, never let me go. They just never let me go. For every concert that disappeared, someone else phoned and said, we know what you're going through. Come sing here. We can't pay your full price, but just come. Yeah. And in 2015, people carried me. In 2016, I bought up the country CD and it went to number one again. So I'm in two minds about my suffering here. As I believe that the rhinos can't speak for themselves, someone else must speak for them. I don't have to wait to be poor to speak for poor people. I don't have to wait to be attacked or murdered to speak for the murdered. I have a platform out there. It's a very popular platform. It is supported very well. I don't abuse it. I do love songs. I'm a singer and I sing songs. But I take 3 minutes of the 90-minute show and I say, this is my campaign. It's very important to me. And I need you to know that if you are an Afrikaner, every time a farmer is killed, something dies inside you. And something will die inside you before Tuesday, even if you don't feel it. And people understand that. They know what I'm speaking about. And I do a small sketch. I still sing Die Stem at my shows. I do a verse of it. It makes me very proud. I put the videos on social media. Thousands and thousands of people, no matter where they are in South Africa, if I sing Die Stem, they put down their drinks. They put down their babies. They stand up. People in wheelchairs are helped up, and they stand with a hand on their heart. I don't tell them to do any of that. They stand up, and they sing a song of a period when you could still scream about your pride in a country. I want to do that with the new South Africa. I want to do that with my black brothers and my colored brothers, because that's the kind of South Africa that I voted for and the kind of South African that I am. But they've made it increasingly difficult for me because my people are now excused from that labor market because of their skin color. I am sick of this war on the West by those who have a rather awful time hiding their envy. I'm sick of a socialist government forcing my taxes away from me, away from my people, away from the taxpayers, away from the interests of my people because they are white. I'm sick of pretending that colonialism did not bring science, medicine, and toilets to those who pretend to despise it. I'm sick of sitting on the fact that life expectancy decreased before and after Western influence, before and after colonialism, life expectancy decreased. What part of apartheid must I apologize for? Must I be happy that more people are dying? I don't get why they want me, why they must force me to make that kind of math. I'm sick of the racism of collective guilt for whites only. I'm sick of counting my words in the company of groups who refuse to acknowledge their group's disproportionate contribution to rape and murder, as we discussed earlier on. Yeah, I'm a pretty sick person at this stage. I'm sick of a lot of things. In Afrikaans, we say, when people say, how are you? We have an Afrikaans saying, Kani Klani, which means I don't complain. But I've stopped saying that because I complain a lot. I say it's going well or it's not going well, but I'm not going to stop complaining. I'm sick and tired of this bigotry, and I can't live in it. I can't love this country if they force me to be like this. I'm sick of the education standard forced upon my children by people whose grandparents couldn't read or write 100 years ago. I'm sick of Hollywood selling me 34 extra genders as the norm. It is crazy. I can't count that anymore. I don't know what to do. I don't know if I must build 34 extra toilets at my schools. Must I pay for it? That's not, nothing to do with politics. I'm sick of the unprecedented leftist biased out there in media and press and school and universities and entertainment, and I know you have the same problem in America. Listen, the list of things that I'm truly sick of. I'm sick of reparations for events before my time, knowing full well that almost everybody has a slave ancestors somewhere, and I'm sick of a lot of things. And I'm not going to keep quiet, and as a poet, it's my responsibility to write songs about our time, about our suffering, and one day people will know what we went through. I think I'm going to make a special point of our ambassadors out there, you two, Mel and Karin and Ed, you guys, who can gain nothing from it, but you still speak on our behalf and you make a noise and you make waves on that side. I'm scared that one day it's too late. The world will never be able to say they didn't know because you contributed and you let them know. I thank you very much for that.
Mel and I have both
seen America. It's really... It's Tattoo Billy. Tattoo Billy got to travel. We've been very fortunate. We got to travel all over the country and spread the word about war genocide. Like I said, we'd have the shows. We trick a lot of people in. We put four show. A lot of people thought they were coming to a pig roast because they were so ignorant to what a boar was. You know what I mean? But once they got there, we'd educate them on what the boar was. They, you know, they were the farmer in South Africa and how they're being killed. So it was a pleasure. I mean, I got to do two of the Red October events in America. That, to me, I call them untainted because there was no anybody involved in those that had some kind of political agenda. They were just all from the heart. And everything I ever did, from writing Tersiasville to Children of Ham, were songs from the heart for South Africa. People wanted them. I gave them to them. I never made any money off of them. So I gave them to anybody that wanted them because I wrote the songs for South Africa. So anything I do, my home, I always open my home. Any South African, it's what if they come to America. It's like, you want to come here and stay here? You can come here. You can stay here. And it's been a great experience. I almost identify myself as a Boer. I'm an American, but my identity is Boer. Many people's confused me as being even South African over the years, so they get to talk to me in person. But it's been a pleasure standing up in this cause, and I don't know how much of the things I've done between a boxing match or writing a song has made a difference, but I have no shame in standing up the way I did, even against the political nature of it here in America, because as you know, as you suffered in South Africa, you can imagine the things I went through in America spreading the word. But it's been a pleasure really being involved in this. It's something I'll continue to do until I leave this world. So I will continuously be involved in spreading the word for my friends, you, Steve, and everybody in South Africa. I consider you guys all my friends, part of my family.
Ed, when I met you, you were obviously a great inspiration. I met you first 4 or 5 years ago. I can't remember, a runabout. And I went back home with a renewed inspiration and verve to rattle the cages of my own people. My own people are responsible for a lot of things that are happening by simply doing nothing, by simply not reporting, by bending over, by sinking willfully, by giving up on a great history and a great culture. And yeah, I run into an American who says he feels more Boer sometimes than American. I had to take that message back to South Africa and say, shame on you, shame on you, that you leave a few of us isolated to fight your fights for you, and you've surrendered, you've given up when people very far from you are fighting for you. And I will never forget that, Ed, and if I had the means, I would erect a monument for you in this country. You have a lot of South African friends, and I hope to meet many more Americans like you. Thank you very much, sir.
And it's like you said, to be quiet is almost you're given permission. If you don't speak up, if you will not resist, even in not, it doesn't have to be physically, but just to speak out, you've got to speak out in this issue. And it's like I tell many people, it's like the Bible says, if you know something's wrong and you have the knowledge of it and you don't speak it, if you don't speak out against that evil, you are just as guilty of that as the people who are doing it, because you're not speaking out in the issue. And that's what I tell people. It's small things. Just speaking out it's such a big issue. And like I said, when I was 40, I was 41 years old when I came out and I fought a fight. And I did it for South Africans. It was not for me. I had nothing to gain from it. It was to show people, if you stand up and fight, you can win. You can win. And it was in memory of Corey Sanders, too, because you remember Corey Sanders. He was murdered, Corey the Sniper Sanders. I got to meet him once. He was a great guy. And I got to know a lot of famous people, you know, even in the boxing world. I had Aaron Pryor was one of my trainers in 1999. He was a junior world heavyweight champion. So when I came out, it was a big, big risk. It took me a year of training to come back and do this fight. And it was all for South Africans. And then along the way, I mean, I lost, you know, I had a wife that passed away. My father passed away. But I still fought the fight. I still stood up and I fought it. And that's the message between my songs, like Tertiousville, Children of Ham, or the fight I did. Stand up and fight. And and in the end, you know, God's really rewarded me back many fold for the things I have done. I got a new wife now. She's a great lady. And I mean, I've lost, but I've gained. So it's worth the risk. It's worth the risk to get out there and spread the word. I mean, the Boer on the Afrikaner, you know, is a unique culture, unlike Native Americans. That's what I tell people. Once they're gone, they're gone. Yeah. Many tribes in America have been lost, you know, and no one knows anything really much about them because they have been wiped out. And it's the same way with the Boer and the Afrikaner today. These are unique cultures that need to be preserved. Their history needs to be preserved. And they're in the endangered of being, you know, wiped out. I mean, and they were stigmatized. I mean, the people do know in America about South Africa only know like what you were talking about, Nelson Mandela. This was a man that was head of Spear of the Nation, you know, as an ANC terrorist wing, you know, that was the most violent. And while he was in prison, he was offered to get out of prison if he would just not orchestrate any bombings or anything else anymore. But he refused. You know,
he refused.
That's the other part of Nelson Mandela that people don't know. You know what I mean? They just know the man that was in, you know, in prison, but they don't know the man that orchestrated behind prison with Spear of the Nation. And so the things I try to spread is these things, you know. The ANC is more responsible for the death of black Africans than anybody. They kill more of their own people than anybody during the apartheid, you know, to the end of the apartheid era. I forget the exact number. It was in the 20 to something odd thousand black Africans that lost, I believe, their life by the ANC alone. I can't quite, you know what I mean? Because
21,000.
You know, yeah. But one of the things, I met what I told you was Franz Moritz out of South Africa. It was helping me. And I was like, this is a friend. That's the kind of guy I am. You know, if you're a friend of mine, I'm going to do what I can do to help out. And Steve, all you guys, I consider you're my friends, and I'm going to continuously try to spread the word through music or whatever means I can to let people know what's going on there for you guys. Best I can.
Thank you very much, Ed. Ah, wonderful. I applaud that. Thank you very much. And I hope a lot of people hear that and start their own, mobilize in their own way, you know, which could contribute on this side. Thank you very much. So what's wrong with you two girls, Karin and Mel? Can't you start a band?
You'll pay me not to sing, Steve, I promise. I promise you. But in honor of Ed doing this for us, the next show, the next song that we have queued up is one of my absolute favorites. It's sung with his father, and it is Praise Him. It's a show, the music I use to end my show every Tuesday night, and one of my favorites. It makes me cry, and I know that this is a tribute to Ed's lost father. So that's the next music we are going to be playing.
Fantastic.
Once I was a blind man, wandering to and fro. Once I was in sin, out of control. But he reached down and picked me up, poured his spirit over me, knocked the scales from my eyes, and now I see.
Praise Him,
praise Him,
praise Him,
praise His holy name. I was in sin, but He loved me just the same.
Praise Him,
praise Him,
praise Him,
the beginning and the end. When I leave this world, I want to be praising His name. Suffer little children, come on to thee. The Lamb's blood is life, He'll set you free. Depressed, oppressed, starving and deep, save your soul. Set your heart free.
Praise Him,
praise Him,
praise Him,
ruler of this world, Lord of Lords and King of Kings.
Praise Him.
Ed, I'd like to thank you very much for that, because Steve has thanked you, but from my point of view, through you, I have met such interesting people, and I've got an American perspective on this story, because no matter, I always say you can take the girl out of South Africa, but you can't take South Africa out of the girl. My heart is always there, and I am South African to my bones, so it's really hard for me to see this, even though I'm married to an American who lived in South Africa for 2 years. He looks at it a completely different way, but your perspective is from the majority point of view. And it's very difficult for me to see South Africa that way. Americans say, stand up and fight, but they don't understand being disarmed and being so few. And you can't make them see it, because they can't see it in their head. So thank you so much, Ed, for all the things you've done for South Africa and all the people you've introduced me to and all the shows of mine you've been on and the music you've provided. The more voices we have out there doing varied and different things to draw attention, like the people we've got writing letters and writing emails, every little bit has to help in the end. You know, and Mel and I don't always agree on methods, but the fact remains that if everybody does something, the world is going to have to turn their eyes back on South Africa and say, what did we do?
Yeah.
Right. And like I said, the real heroes are the people that are in South Africa today, like Steve, that really got to deal
yeah.
with the situations. And yeah. What I'm doing, I think, is what any good Samaritan should be doing to spread the word for anybody that would be under such circumstances. And like I said, I just feel good that Tattoo Billy, its legacy has really been established just in that. I think we were a huge part in spreading the word in America about the Boer genocide and what's happening with the Afrikaner. And it's like you said, Karin, there's more than just the Boer. You got the, you know, the Afrikaner that is being assaulted and brutalized in cities and stuff like yeah. that. That's not being talked about as well. And so it's, to me, like I said, for Steve to stand up like he has, he's mm-hmm. suffered and risked mm-hmm. more than anybody to help spread this word. And I mean, it's just amazing that Steve, this artist from South Africa, is really worldwide, I think,
yeah,
spread the yeah. word for genocide and himself. So to me, Steve's my hero. I mean, I see just what he's done meeting this guy, because when I met him in Chicago, I've been around enough to know this guy's the real deal. He's yeah. the real deal.
Yeah.
And he believes in what he's doing. And so to me, just to be today on this show is just a pleasure for me too, even though I've been listening mostly, but just to listen to Steve talk, you know what I mean? It's just an amazing thing for me. So thank you for having me on here today.
Yeah, thank you, Ed, for being with us. Always a pleasure to have you with us. We would really like to talk a little bit about current affairs and what's going on in South Africa, since you're actually in South Africa, Steve, if you want to talk about...
Mel, just before you go, I'm going to try and put this in here.
Oh,
and you'll see the picture of myself and Ed in Chicago right there.
Wow.
I hope you can see that.
Yes.
Can you see that, Ed? You know you're in this book.
Oh,
yes.
That's awesome. Oh,
it's a book that I gave out when I turned 50, and it is in it.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you, absolutely awesome.
Nice one.
Sorry, I interrupted you. You wanted to?
Yeah, we've got a few minutes left, and obviously we want to hear you play out. So give us a little bit about what's been going on in South Africa in the last few days.
The ANC, which is the party in power, they've been in power for 21 years now, elected a new president for the party, which inevitably becomes the president of South Africa. It was between him and the wife of the former president, which we are very glad we've had it with that family. No more of them. I'm not sure if I'm elated at all, you know. I don't know if I'm going to be jubilant if any socialist president tries to run this country. He's a multi-billionaire, so I think he plays the socialist in the political side, but back at home he's a capitalist. At least he speaks well. He's eloquent. You can understand what he says. He seems to be a gentleman. We're speaking about Cyril Ramaphosa, who will probably be the new president of South Africa if all things go well. I think we're in bigger trouble than just the president. You know, we need a complete change of mind. We need a paradigm shift, complete change of mind about our things. I am just amazed that South Africa will be the last country that will hammer on about how socialism will save a developing nation when it will most certainly not save this one, because it hasn't saved any of the others on this continent. But of course, there's a cow out there. It's called the white person, and you can milk that cow. So the former president promised complete free education for all poor people in South Africa. And once again, that doesn't fall out of the sky. It'll come from someone. Someone will be milked dry for that money. We are already a junk status economy. It's very hard to turn this one around. I think very soon it'll be better to drain Bitcoin than in South African rands for South Africans. It's just crazy what's happening down here. So yeah, we're into a new year. There's a bit of excitement and optimism in the air, I think. Let's see where it takes us. Every bit does help. But for my people, life carries on as usual. We are ruled by foreign people with foreign ideas. We are all South Africans, yes. We do not hate each other. we will stand, we are in this together. We are going to have to sort this out by ourselves as well. But I am being run, my life is being run by foreigners, by people with completely different values to mine. Never mind socialist, communist, just a wide range of other things that we will never agree on. And I believe that the country is where it is because of those systems.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for that. All right. I would love to hear you play some more before we head off this evening.
Let's get the guitar out here. Let me play you a part of my... I'm going to sit back further so you can see the guitar as well. My father's favorite song was always a Neil Diamond song, and I'll do you a verse of that. It's fine, the sun shines most of the time, and the feeling is laid back. Palm trees grow, rent so low, what you know, keep thinking about making my way back. Well, I'm New York City born and raised. Nowadays I'm lost between two shores. LA's fine, but it ain't home. New York's home, but it ain't mine no more. Oh, I quiet. I am a sin to no one there. And no one heard at all, not even the chair. You know it's leaving me lonely still. Thank you. And a verse of STEM, is there still time?
Yes, you've got a special request. Request from the producer, please, everybody except Steve, switch off your camera.
And your microphone, so we can hear you coming through clearly for this one, Steve.
Switch off the camera.
Not you, Steve, not you.
All right.
Ed, if you wouldn't mind just switching off your camera and your mic, that would be brilliant, and then we can hear you clearly for this one.
All right. Just for the English folk listening, the lyrics that I'm going to sing now go like this, translated: ringing out from our blue heavens, from our deep seas breaking round, over everlasting mountains where the echoing crags resound, from our plains where creaking wagons cut their trails into the earth, calls the spirit of our country, of the land that gave us birth. At thy call we shall not falter, firm and steadfast we shall stand, at thy will to live or perish, O South Africa, dear land. I'll be doing it in Afrikaans. Let's do one verse of that. Ed, I think you're standing. That's the spirit. All right, let's do it. A deep low from onze hemel, a deep diepte van ons ziel. Ons eeuwige gebertes, waar die kansen aan toe geeft. Hier ons verlate plaatjes, met die kreeën van onze paal. Reis die stem van ons geliefde, van ons land Zuid-Afrika. Ons sal antwoord op jou roepstem, ons sal offer wat jy vraag. Ons sal lewe, ons sal sterwe, ons vir jou sy Afrika.
Oh, wow. Both of us are in tears.
It does it to me as well.
You must be glad my mic was muted because I sang along with you.
Oh, I'm sorry, Miss, but thank you. Thank you very much. So every night on stage, four times a week, I get this reaction. I see what people do, and I know that the spirit is still there, you know, and we'll find a way to channel it in South Africa.
Yeah.
Steve, thank you very, very much. And Ed, thank you so very much for helping me organize this. It is a wonderful way for us to end the year, showing that we are resilient, despite all the terrible things we've spoken about on our programs this year.
Yeah.
South Africa spirit is still strong. The people are strong. They are still creative. They still love their country, as do we. And we need to show the world that, that we are not just doom and gloom. We have a sense of humor. We are happy people. We are musical people, not me. But we are musical people. And the world needs to see us as people, not apartheid monsters. So you've seen us here today in all our finery, in all our glory, trying to bring you some happiness at this festive time of year. Thank you so much, Steve, for contributing so greatly to this.
Thank you, guys. You have my address anytime. Mel, thank you very much for your hospitality. Ed, I salute you, my friend, and we'll speak again on social media. Karin, thank you for your eloquence and verbalizing all this stuff so wonderfully. I really appreciate it.
We love our country, Steve. We love our country.
Yes. Well, we hang towards the end of the show, so I'm going to wrap this up and say a big thank you to Ed for joining us all the way from the States, and of course Steve for joining us all the way from South Africa. It has just been an absolute privilege and pleasure and honor to be with you this evening, and of course to my most esteemed co-host Karin Smith. You know how much I love you, and thank you for organizing this as well. You're amazing, and we continue the show as planned next year. We've got the first 2 months of next year completely booked up with guests, guys, so make sure you are tuning in to Stop South African Genocide in the regular slot, 7 p.m. GMT on Conscious Consumer Network. And that is it for tonight. We're going to sign off. Please do watch the archive on ccn.media and continue to support free and independent media, because we are the only people talking about what's really going on in South Africa. Mainstream media is heavily censored. Independent media gives you the truth. So keep us supported, guys, and we love you all. Thanks for tuning in. Good night.
Thank you very much. Good night.
If we want to change the world, we must first change the media. Mainstream media exists for the purposes of indoctrination and manipulation of public perception. The world of free and independent media is growing, and with the upsurge in information now available in the public domain, it has never been easier to access free and independent media. The exploration of this information resulted in an experimental project which would provide a fully supported space for researchers, whistleblowers, and seekers of all kinds to express themselves and educate the world. On the 1st of January 2015, Conscious Consumer Network was launched to the world. Nobody thought we would make it this far, but CCN is the longest running free and independent media network of its kind. CCN is a unique collaboration of hearts and souls, bringing you information from different perspectives to educate and inform. Since we started CCN, we have had only one desire, the pursuit of a free, fair, just, sustainable world, and this has not changed. Having overcome many challenges over the last 2 years, CCN is here to stay, and we've got great things lined up for 2017. Help keep CCN on the air by supporting the 2017 Network Support Fund.